Hi there, and welcome to this video introducing the use of gross and renderable areas. The video is one in a series of videos focusing on quantities and schedules in Revit 2014. In the video, we'll model a simple building. We will make an area plan showing the area, a gross area. We'll create a schedule, writing out the data from our area plan. And finally, we'll look into the phenomena called renderable areas. Okay, I'll get started and make a new project based on the metric default template. I will model a simple building. Ten times ten. And that will be the outer parameter of the building. So we know that the exact gross area will be 100 square meter. Before continuing, I just want to make sure that the height of this is constrained to level 2. I'll now make a type of floor plan that's called an area plan, and we will make it a gross the type gross building, and we'll do it for level 1. And as you notice, Revit will automatically create area boundary lines associated with the external walls, and that's the blue line you see here. Furthermore, you notice in the browser that we have a new area plan called level 1. I'll just create default 3D view and duplicate these to my second level, so I have a two-story building. Which means that I also have to create an area plan for my level 2. And that should be gross. Yes again. And now I have two area plans. Furthermore, we could write out a schedule. Go to schedules, quantities, and take areas gross building. And we might want to write out the area and the name and maybe level. Okay, and now I notice that I have area on level 1 with 100 square meters and area on level 2 with 100 square meters. Of course, the area plan can be subdivided if I want to change the area boundary and maybe split it because the building contains different functions. Then I now have an area of 60 square meters here, and I will just tag this one, the other area, and now my schedule should have been updated as well. So I now have three different areas. And we could sort these by level. Okay. The last thing I want to introduce is based on a similar principle. It's what's called renderable areas, and you see a small description of it here. The renderable area types are multiple, and it's based on measurement rules for office buildings in America. The renderable areas are not the same as the net areas, but I'll just briefly show you how they are created. I could go to my level 1 floor plan. I could make my own area scheme based on the renderable. This one needs to be marked as a new, and I rename it renderable test, say OK, and now I want to create a new area plan based on the type called renderable test, and I want to do that for both levels, OK. And now again we will automatically create area boundary lines associated with the external walls. And that applies for both levels. And again, I have my area planes down here. And I'm now able to again subdivide them. Let's draw a few internal walls. Like this. And one here maybe. And then make a few boundary lines like this, and maybe one here, center of the walls. And we could tag him with an area. And these are of course the renderable areas. And I'll do the same thing up here. Area. And we could write out a schedule again for the renderable test type. Okay, an area, level, and maybe a name. Okay, and now I see a nice schedule with the areas on my level 1 and the areas as well. One last thing I could show is that the areas here have different area types. Let's say that this is an office area and this is a floor area. I don't know the definition of it, but they have different area types. And I could now make a color scheme based on the different types here and say okay, and now they're colored differently. I could of course also rename them. Test 1 and test 2. And again, you notice that in the schedule it nicely changes the name. Okay, that was it for now. Thank you for listening and hope to see you in upcoming videos. Goodbye.